In this video, I'll be giving a very basic overview of the Epson Perfection V600 photo scanner, and I'll be describing how to scan in field negatives using the software provided. The level will be very basic, and for those with experience, some of the things I say will be quite obvious, but they won't be obvious to people who don't have experience. I won't be covering any advanced scanning techniques. I won't be looking at any specialised third-party scanning software, and I won't be doing any comparisons. When I started doing my research for a scanner, I whistled it down to two models, this one and the Canon CanoScan 9000F Mark II. I'm a huge Canon fan, all of my cameras and lenses are Canon, and I'm sure the Canon 9000F Mark II is an excellent scanner, but in the end I plumped for this one, and because I just bought this one, I can't give you a comparison between this and the Canon. Let's begin by taking a look at the hardware, and then I'll move on to the Epson scanning software.
The scanner is quite large and heavy. I actually had to buy a desk extension to accommodate it. Previous to this one, I had a small Canon scanner. It was very small and light, but because of that, my cat managed to push it on the floor, and optical scanners don't stand up to drop testing very well, and I just threw it away. I don't think the cat could knock this one on the floor, even if she wanted to. It's roughly 48 centimetres deep, 28 centimetres wide, and about 12 centimetres high, and the weight is 4.1 kilograms. The on-off switch is on the side, and around the back is the USB port for the computer connection, and also a socket for an external power supply. My old Canon scanner, which was quite small, took its power from the USB, but this one draws too much current and needs an external power supply. On the front are two lights. There's a light just to show that the scanner's switched on, and an error light, and there are four buttons. The PDF button scans a document and then creates a PDF file. The email button will only work with certain email programs. And if it does work with your program, it will create an email attachment and add it to an email. There's also a photocopy button, so if you configure it to connect to your printer, just by pressing this button, it will scan a document and then send that file straight to your printer. And the fourth button is a scan button. When scanning regular documents, you need to have this white document mat installed underneath the cover. And in that mode, the light source comes from underneath the glass. So the light points up, reflects off the document, and then back down again into the image sensor. If you're scanning books or thick documents, the hinge has a special mechanism whereby you can lower it while still keeping it roughly parallel to the scanner glass. The process for scanning film negatives is quite different to the process for scanning documents. With documents, the light source is underneath, so the light source points up, reflects off the document, and then goes back down into the image sensor. With a film negative, the light source needs to be above, and it shines through the negative into the image sensor. So what we need to do is to remove this document mat, which moves quite easily, and you'll see another light source above. This light source is a lot smaller, but that isn't a problem because film negatives are a lot smaller than documents. So for scanning film negatives, all we need to do is remove that document mat. Place your film negative in a holder. I'll be showing you how to do that in a few seconds. Place the holder onto the glass bed, and you're all ready to go. Epson give you two film negative holders with the scanner. This one is for medium format film, and as I've never done any medium format film, I've never used this one. The one I use is this one, and it has slots for strip film and also for slides. At this point, some people will criticize me for not wearing white cotton gloves. I prefer just to use my fingers, and I hold the film by the edge and do my best not to get any fingerprints on the negatives. If your negatives are flat, like this one, it's quite an easy job. A couple of years ago, I went through the process of scanning several thousand negatives, and they're all like this, and it was fairly straightforward. If, however, your film comes back from the lab like this, where it's very curly, it can be a really fiddly task. Regarding orientation of the negative, there's a little logo to help you here. On the side of the negative, you'll see some manufacturer's information. And what you basically want is for the front of the negative to point down and for the bottom to face this way. So just take this part out, slide in the negative. There are two slots. Each slot will take six frames, so you can have 12 frames in total. And then just clip this back in to keep the negative flat. Once you've put the negatives into the holder, you then need to put the holder into the scanner, and there are little locating pins to help you, A. And in addition to trying to keep the negatives free from fingerprints, you also need to keep everything as dust-free as possible using either a cloth or maybe a little air puffer. Once your negatives are in the holder and the holder's in the scanner, you'll release a scan. So just fire up the Epson Scan utility. You can do this through your computer, or you can just press the scan button on the scanner. You will see that there are four modes. There's a full auto mode, home mode, office mode, and professional mode. With office mode, you cannot scan negatives. Office mode is meant for an office environment where you have a large amount of documents to scan, and you're using the automatic document feed accessory. Home mode and professional mode requires user intervention. So after you press the scan button, you need to do something before the files go on your computer. With full auto mode, there is no intervention. And if you're faced with the task, as I was a few years ago, of having to scan in thousands of negatives, and you want to do this as quickly as possible, I would recommend full auto mode. So all you need to do is set it on full auto mode, customize it. So just tell it if you want to do dust removal or color restoration, and the resolution that you want to scan at. Tell it where to save the files. And then all you need to do is put the negatives in the scanner, press the scan button, and the files will go straight to your computer. You don't need to do anything. Once you have digitized all of your negatives by using the full auto mode, you can then go through them and select the ones that you would like to improve the appearance of. And you can use home mode or professional mode to do this. With home mode, you get a limited number of options: color restoration, backlight correction, digital ice. This is the digital image correction and enhancement feature. It removes dust, scratches, hairs, fingerprints. What it does, it actually scans negative twice. The first scan uses the normal lamp, and then it scans with an infrared lamp. And the infrared light detects all the imperfections in the negative. And then using that information, it then scans with the normal lamp to remove all of those imperfections. To improve the image quality of selected negatives, I recommend professional mode. This has a lot of options, and it will allow you to get the best possible image quality from any one negative. However, it takes quite a long time to do this, and this is why I don't recommend professional mode for the initial task of scanning in thousands of negatives. For that task, I recommend full auto mode, because there's no user intervention required, and it's the quickest way of getting your negative scanned in. I'll just give you a quick demonstration of professional mode in action. So in this dialog box, you need to set the adjustments how you want them. You don't have a scan option, you just have a preview, so click the preview button. I then get a preview window, and here I can rotate the images if I want to, or mirror them. Once I'm happy, click the scan button. There's another dialog box comes up, just confirming where I'm going to store the images. Click OK. And it then starts scanning the images into my computer. If you have a document to scan, not a negative, you can do it straight from Photoshop. Just go into File, Import, WIA Support, which is Windows Image Acquisition. Leave these boxes checked or uncheck them as you desire, and just press Start. It will then look to see what the available scanners are on the network. I've got three, so I'm going to choose the Epson Perfection. Then it gives me the options for color picture, grayscale picture, black and white, or custom. I'm just going to leave it in color. I can do a scan, or I can preview and then scan. If I do a quick preview, this is my 85-year-old edition of Aesop's Fables. And it's already cropped it for me, and I can scan. So this is good for documents, but you can't scan film negatives this way. If you have negatives to scan in, either from your day shooting film, or indeed if you still shoot film, the easiest option is just to ask your developing lab to do the scans for you. Most labs will offer that option. With me, I wanted a little more control over the process, and I wanted to do it myself. When I started looking at scanners, I wanted decent quality and didn't want a really cheap scanner, but neither did I want to pay a fortune. And I eventually narrowed it down to this one, the Epson V600, and the Canon 9000F Mark II. I'm sure the Canon scanner is fine, but I eventually chose this one, and I have no regrets. There haven't been any reliability issues, and the image quality is very good, both on documents and film negatives. If you're lucky enough to live in the US, where the prices for photography and electronic equipment are about the cheapest in the world, this retails for about $200, which I think is excellent value. I had to order it specially in Thailand, and it cost me twice that amount, but I've still been very pleased with it, and it's a scanner that I'm quite happy to recommend. Well, I hope this has been useful. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, please subscribe to my channel. And thanks for watching.